We develop technologies to remove plastics from the high seas. We developed this system of very long floating barriers with a screen underneath that reaches down several meters, floating along with the currents in such a way that there is a pressure difference on one side of the system to the other. So the plastic that is moving around in the currents on the ocean is actually floating against our barriers and collected because of the shape. The shape is like a horseshoe, and then because of the pressure of the water, the current coming in, the plastic concentrates in the middle, so it comes to a level of concentration that we can actually lift it out, bring it back on shore for recycling. Yes, Boyan was 16 years old when he was on a vacation in Greece, and during a dive realized there were more plastic bags than fish that he saw, and that made him think, and that's the way the guy is. Like, why don't we clean this up? Why isn't nobody doing something about it? And then he started a high school project. He needed to do a high school project, so he defined this project to think of something to clean the oceans. And rather than 2 weeks, it took him a year, I think. And he presented this, and it got attention from somebody who was working at the university. So he was invited to come and do a presentation at the university, and there's somebody from the local TED, the TEDx Delft, saw him and invited him to TEDx. That was filmed, it got online, and after a year it went viral. And that is basically how it started. So it really started rolling, and then he realized that he started something that he couldn't stop anymore. Yeah, something we never done, that nobody ever had done before. Basically, to break it down into two major challenges that we had was, on the one side, what is out there? How big is the problem really? What does it look like? So we went out for the mega expedition, as we called it, and we sailed out with 30 ships, collected plastic, a massive effort to build a sample database of plastic from the Northern Pacific. After we'd done that, we realized that there might still be statistical challenges in extrapolating the information that we had from these 30 boats to the entire area, which is three times the size of France, two times the size of Texas, sort of. What we did next was we rented an airplane, fitted it out with the most advanced sensoring equipment that you could think of, and went over the place so you can cover a much larger area than with the 30 boats. And we had all these measuring points, so we use that to detect larger pieces of debris. And putting that all of that together led to a publication that we're bringing out in Scientific Reports, which will tell you, or will tell the whole world, how much plastic is out there, how big is it, what kind of plastics did we find, what is the size distribution of the plastic. There's a lot of attention for microplastics. However, what we find is that of the plastic in that area, 92% is bigger, so it's not microplastic. So 8% in weight is microplastics. In number of pieces, microplastics win, but in actual mass, in the amount of product that is out there, 92% is larger than 5 millimeters. The other thing we did, next to identifying the problem, was the engineering of the system. So this is a very big system. We're talking about floaters that are 1 to 2 kilometers in size. We're still determining the final optimal size. And they shouldn't break, because you are very far away from shore. We're 2,000 kilometers away from San Francisco, 2,000 kilometers away from Hawaii. There's nothing out there. There's no support. So if you put a system there, you should be pretty certain that it works, that it is not breaking, and that it doesn't need a lot of maintenance. So you try to make it as simple as possible, take out moving parts, look very carefully at all the work that has been done on other engineering challenges, and try to put something together that combines it all and can withstand that situation for many years. And that's a big challenge. We did enormous amount of testing on scale models, on prototypes. We put models out in the North Sea, stuff breaks. We check the ultimate limit conditions of materials that we're using. And now we're ready. We have a full design. We are ordering the first equipment to come into San Francisco for construction. And it's going to be built. Yeah, the next stages are coming up very clear now. In April, we will do a tow test in the Bay of San Francisco with a part of the system, which is important because we need to determine at what speed we can tow the barrier out to the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. It's a very long distance, so even if you can do a tiny bit faster, it reduces the time of transfer enormously. The next stage is that we're going to finalize the system. It's going to be 600 meters, 2,000 feet in length, and we will tow it out to the international waters, which is 200 miles, nautical miles away from San Francisco. And there we will let it go for the first time. And it will float, it will be autonomous, and we can validate all our computer models that we have made to predict how the system will behave. We hope for some weather, see how it works, how it holds up, maybe get some stuff that we still need to check and adapt, take that back to shore again, which is, again, that's a long trip. 200 miles is already taking a couple of days. Make final adjustments, and then second half of May, well, this was second half of May, that was the test, and then late July, we will depart from San Francisco under the Golden Gate Bridge to the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. Hopefully bringing back the first plastic on shore October, November. It's hard to predict. We're depending on how much plastic is actually floating there where we put the system, but we're confident that by the end of the year, we have proven the concept of the ocean cleanup. Okay, well, there's a number of things I need to tell you about this. So first of all, our system is designed to remove plastics larger than 10 millimeters. The definition of microplastics is smaller than 5, so we will not touch the microplastic problem. On the other end, as I already indicated, 92%, so only 8% of the product of the mass that is around there is microplastic. So that is the portion we won't be able to capture. It's a little bit more, it's 10%, because we have the 10 millimeter break and not the 5 millimeter break. So the majority of the material we will be able to collect. What is important is that this material is shedding microplastics as it is. We have, for example, found a bottle crate, which is about this big. It's dated back to 1977. You can see, if you hold it, you can see that it has been in the ocean for decades, and it smells of the ocean. It's very worn, and if you rub your finger over it, you can feel that you are removing particles. And that's exactly what's happening. So you have these big particles, big parts that are slowly moving in the waves, and the little parts of plastic, the microplastics, are shedding off of these big ones. It's a mine for microplastics. It will deliver microplastics for the coming decades before that big piece is completely gone. So we think it's a ticking time bomb. These big parts need to be removed as soon as possible to avoid that we continue to add to the microplastic problem. Well, the system is designed, to remove 5 tons of plastic per month. Eventually, we will remove tens of thousands of tons in total. The maximum, because there's going to be a peak. We will ramp up our cleanup effort in 2 years, and then we reach a peak of removal, which will be, I cannot give you the actual number, but it will be more than 10,000 tons that year. And then it will slowly go down again because we are removing plastic. So the efficiency per system is actually going down. The total amount of plastic will be reported soon, so I'm keeping that a little bit of a secret, but it's a staggering amount of material that we will remove. Yeah, we will start in the North Pacific for a simple reason. It's the worst place, so the chance of success is highest, and we do need success because success will drive the funding of the follow-up operations, we hope. But after that, the ambition is definitely to go to the other gyres and put our cleanup systems there as well. If everything goes well, and we do manage also to, as a population of this planet, to reduce the influx of plastic from the rivers and the coast into the oceans, our calculations show we should be able to to remove 90% of the plastic by 2040. Yeah, we started with crowdfunding and we managed to raise a staggering $2.2 million US dollars to start the ocean cleanup. And by now we have raised almost 40 million euros. So we have continued to work on that, and we are funded right now for the first year of operation for that first system. So we feel very, very confident in that. But after that, we will need to raise much, much more money. Crowdfunding alone is not going to do it. So we do address a lot of high net worth individuals, and we have a very big network. It's incredible how many people are concerned about the state of the oceans, and apparently we are able to convince them that what we are doing is a good destination for their money, and I think that. That's an important part. The other part is that we do get a lot of support from corporations, corporations that somehow do something that can be connected to our work, either in kind or financially, and yeah, we're very grateful for that as well. The systems, when they are out there, will be monitored by the ships that go out to collect the plastic. And there's all kinds of measurements on the systems too that we will monitor from shore. And that when we get signals that something is wrong, that there is water in one of the holds, or when a system is moving to a direction where they're not supposed to go, or when we notice there's breakage because the tension of the barrier is gone, we will send one of the ships there and go and either repair it on the spot, which will be very hard. I mean, at the high seas, that's going to be very unlikely. So probably then the system will have to be towed back in. But we do, again, as I mentioned before, we do design for minimum maintenance requirements. So we try to make it as robust as possible. There's no moving parts, but also there's a lot of electronics with solar paneled. Solar-driven electricity to power all the equipment on the system. There's cameras, there's GPS systems. So we try to be as close to them virtually as we can, so we can send in a support ship if necessary. Very good point. That's a very good point. There's basically two big concerns that are raised. We try to have a very open eye for that. One of them is the interaction with marine traffic, so ships that go through the area and find their way blocked by one or multiple of our systems. And the other one is the interaction with marine life. We are talking to marine researchers, marine biologists around the world. Special attention for several aspects, whether or not the systems are going to attract a lot of fish. That's going to be a fish aggregation device, so it will be like a bar for sharks to go there and have great lunch. The other one is the interaction with marine mammals. There's whale migration along the coast, and nobody exactly knows where those whales are, is one of the things we're finding out. And the other one is turtle migration. And when we talk to the researchers in the field, it's interesting to see that they realize that what we are offering too is an observation platform in the middle of the ocean. And so we are talking to a lot of researchers in the marine mammal and turtle field to see whether or not we can cooperate and provide our presence in the middle of the ocean as a platform for them to do observations. What we will do in the first year of operation is 24/7. For the full year observation on the spot. So we will be there to see how the interaction of the system, if there's interaction with marine life, and how the interaction is taking place, to establish whether or not there are any risks. In the meantime, we have done a study by an independent agency, CSA Ocean Sciences, who did an environmental impact study assessment for the systems. Basically, the answer is that it's all expected to be negligible, but yeah, since we've never done it before, we'd better be there, keep an eye on it, and we hope that in 1 year we have enough data to feel comfortable about that we're safe.